Welcome to I choke every time. Okay. Welcome to Crafting Geek Podcast, the podcast about making cosplay and all around geek life. I am one of your hosts, Eric, also known as Core Geek, and with me is that's you, Jackie.
Hey, I'm Jackie. Jackie Craft Cosplay. But you can call me Ruth or Bruce. I answer to both.
Oh, Bruce today. Okay.
Bruce. You know, sometimes I feel like Bruce.
Hey, Bruce, I am really excited because this other guy that's on the podcast right now is Mr. Stephen K. Smith from SKS Props. Hey, Steve.
I'm excited.
A good friend of both of ours. And he just also had last night an appearance on the sci-fi TV show Cosplay Melee. So welcome to the podcast, Stephen.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Well, you have been through the battle as well.
Oh my gosh, and what a battle it was.
And you survived. Like, how'd you do that?
Barely.
Really barely.
Okay, so to kind of get this episode rolling, if you're not familiar with Stephen and his work, you should be. And you can find his website at skspprops.com. He's also on Facebook. And are you on Instagram? I can't remember if you're on Instagram.
Yeah, Instagram and Twitter, it's at SKS Props, but on Facebook, it's still Stephen K. Smith Props. Haven't switched it over yet.
So. Gotcha. So that's where you'll find him.
All the time.
We'll also make sure that that's in the show outline too as well. So you can easily find Stephen and his work. And just kind of as a quick, like a little note, I've known Stephen for more than a couple years, and he's one of the most pro guys I know, and the guy is a hell of a painter. I mean, dang, bro, your paint jobs just slay it every time. And so, and that kind of segues into like an intro for you. Like, where did you get your start with all this madness of costuming and prop building and that kind of stuff?
Well, actually, before all of this cosplay stuff, I went to school for art, for illustration in particular, and I was a freelance illustrator for 15 years. And so I took lots of painting classes and lots of art classes, like color theory, all that kind of good stuff. And when we went to school, we didn't have all of the like Adobe and Wacom tablets and all that. So we did everything traditional. So like when we mixed paint and painted, we did it with traditional mediums. You know, we learned the differences between brushes, that sort of thing. And then that's really helped me, though, get into the whole making my props look decent. You know, I always say that you can have a great prop and a bad paint job and you'll completely destroy it, but you could have a decent prop and an excellent paint job and you can save it.
Oh man, that's couldn't be more true. I've painted terrible pieces made by other people, you know, like my brother, and it ends up like, all right.
Well, you're already throwing your brother under the bus.
He's going to be so mad about that.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I didn't know you had an art background. Both of you have like a graphics design background or some illustration.
Oh, I was going to say, yeah, illustrators and graphic designers. Don't do that, Jackie. Ooh, Those are different. Those are different cliques.
We're going to have
is it like special effects and prop making? Like, I'm just really.
Yeah, actually, that is a very good way to put it.
Yeah. All right. So, yeah, well, actually, when I went to school, I went to believe it or not, the program I went through for my degree was actually both. It was graphic design and illustration. So, and it was kind of like that, like half of the class was really into the graphic design part of it. Half of the group was really into the illustration part of it. And we had like beat down rumbles every day. You know, it was crazy. It was crazy up in there. Let me tell you. And what? catching a Pantone marker in the eye, it hurts really bad. So there you go.
What is this? I didn't realize art school was so physical.
It's tough. It's rough, man. So I'm glad to hear you made it through the gauntlet there, Stephen, because I know it was rough for me. So, and how was that working as a freelance illustrator? I mean, working freelance is not easy.
And you did that not easy at all
for many, many years.
Yeah. Before all that, I worked retail, you know, that was my full-time job. And then you got your freelance gigs every now and then. But before all this, I was the number one appliance salesperson at Lowe's in the entire Kansas City area. So,
wow, that's impressive.
Yeah, I went from appliance guy to costume maker. So
Well,
what kind of stuff did you create? What kind of freelance work did you do? Anything fun or just kind of?
No, nothing fun. That's the worst part.
Nothing fun at all.
Is that when you go to cons nowadays and you look at Artist Alley, how many people draw? Lots and lots of people draw.
Yeah.
But how many people build stuff? And I mean, it's very, very small number. And so the freelance market is extremely tough. Nobody wants to give contacts or anything because, oh, that guy might take my job. That's the completely different part about cosplay is that everyone's open. Everyone's giving, you know, information, ideas, tips, tricks. The community is so much better.
And passing jobs along. I've passed jobs on. I've gotten a job because it's been passed on to me. So I definitely, it's a shame to hear that the art, I mean, I guess there is, the art world can be kind of saturated, but the prop and costume design world is sort of feeling, you know, that it's getting a lot more saturated, but I guess there's not as many people that do it full time or do commission work as there are artists.
I think that's the biggest thing.
Well, I have a friend that's been a technical illustrator, and I know you know what that is. So he does, like, you know, if you buy like an HP printer and you open up the little manual in it, and there's like a, you know, little graphic of a dude like loading the whatever, he drew that. He drew all those things, right? So that's all technical illustration. And I know, like, for him, it's like, you want to keep those clients in your pocket because those are like his bread and butter clients. Right. And so, if he loses that client to somebody else, that's an X amount of dollars he's not making per month to feed his family. So in that world, I can see how having, like clients in a way, and you don't want to share that information because it really comes down to, are you making a paycheck or not? You know, because like for him, he's been doing it for like 20 years and that's been his sole occupation for 20 years, you know, as a technical illustrator, which even that's kind of slowing down for him because there's so many opportunities for art now. And teaching clients that, you know, hey, a hand drawn piece of art has a different value than just a piece of clip art too. So, and is that something that you ran into with your stuff kind of thing, or were you ever in that kind of world?
No, definitely. I mean, that's where, everything went from doing a traditional to, you know, I had to go buy a Wacom board and I had to learn Adobe Photoshop and all that to keep up with, how the creative society has changed. You know, nobody wants you to draw it by hand anymore because they're like, well, we want to change that, we want to add different colors and all that. Well, in Photoshop, you're just like, all right, new layer, different color, you know, it's all good, you know. And that's where I think that I enjoy the prop making side of it because it's doing stuff with my hands again. You know, it's not that it's not all digital. It's crafting, you know, by hand, sculpting out of clay, you know, making stuff out of foam floor mats.
So how did that transition from being number one appliance salesman and illustrator to I'm now a full time prop maker?
Man, it was nuts. All right. It happened so fast. I didn't know what cosplay was. Didn't know anything about that whole community. Hadn't ever gone to a comic book convention.
Year was this? Like, how long ago?
This is 4 years ago.
4 years, okay.
Yeah. And of course, I had tons of comic books and everything, but never went to a convention. And some friends of mine that worked at Lowe's with me, we played Borderlands every single night. I mean, for hours, we played Borderlands. And they're like, hey, you know, the local cons come and they just upgraded this new area. It's like twice as big. We're all going to go and we're going to dress as Borderlands characters. And I was like, what? I was like, I'm good with going, but like, what's the whole dressing up part? And like, oh, that's what people do now. You know, you go to the convention, you dress up. And I was like, all right. I mean, I'll do it if you guys do it. And so.
What time was it?
This was a Planet Comic Con in Kansas City.
Oh, okay. Hey, aren't you returning to that?
I am. I'm going to be a guest there in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I was going to say, aren't you? You're now a guest of it. So you went from four years ago. I don't know what this weird thing is. I'm going to put on a costume. I'm going to go hang out with some friends in public and have a great time. To now, you're going as like, hey, Stephen K. Smith's going to be here.
They're doing special panels, you know, Q&As and all that kind of stuff. I'm going to do painting demos there, so it should be fun.
Oh, really? You're going to do some interactive kind of stuff. That's cool.
Yeah.
I love demos. I wish more cons did like workshops and demos or live builds. Gosh, that's my favorite thing. Whenever that happens, it's like, oh man, it's so rare though. I did a breastplate build. When I returned to my very first con, the one that I talked about in my episode, I did like a live breastplate build that people could sign up for and come sit and watch. And I know Kamui, Svetlana did a live build maybe at a League of Legends event one year. And so a few cons have done it, but man, that would be, I love that. I think that would be really cool because special effects cons do it. Like I just listened to a Tested podcast where they were talking about Monsterpalooza or something where they did that. So,
yeah, this is the first year Kansas City's trying it out. And so for the entire weekend, there's going to be different artists in this area every day. And just some are sculpting, some are painting, you know, so it should be fun.
So do you know what you're going to be doing yet? Like, have you made
I decided I was going to take one of my original creations masks up there and paint that.
Oh, very cool. So, mentioning your original creations, tell us a little bit about that because I know you've gone from, you know, doing, well, as you can see, if you're watching this on video, we're on YouTube, by the way, you can see in the background there, Steve has a lot of really cool costumes, but they're all from other properties. And recently you started delving into creating original pieces of your own design, correct?
Yeah. I got kind of burned out on the whole replicating thing. I've done that for years and I'm really good, but it's just replicating someone else's work. And that artist side of me really wants to get back into creating again. And so I started delving around with some ideas. And last year I came up with this whole Wasteland Alice in Wonderland character. And I was like, you know what, it'd be fun just to draw again. And I put it out there for my fans and like it took off. And people are like, wow, that's really awesome. I think there's a market for that kind of stuff. You go to these cons, how many Deadpools do you see? You know, how many Harleys do you see? It's like people are wanting new cool things to dress up as, because it's not just you don't have to dress up as just a comic person or a movie person. You know, Zach Fisher has proved that you can go out there and you can make your own versions of these characters and people still going to love it.
Yeah. And they request it. They have a lot of these people like Sunset Dragon and other people that I love and follow. They have, like Tag Kun Design. I'm definitely not saying her name right, but there's all these people that I am such a fan of. They're like own interpretive designs of you know, classic characters that almost have like massive followings. And these people have waits for commissions to do more and more redesigns. Yeah. So I think that, I think it's different. It's definitely, I don't know. It's kind of, you have a little bit of leeway. Like when you create something that's a replica, my issue with that, I'm doing a replica right now after doing a lot of spin-offs of my own versions of things. And you open yourself up to a different type of critique. The critique, when you copy someone's character, for that audience that love that character, man, they're going to notice everything. They're going to, and whether or not you care if someone critiques it, you still are going to see that set of critiques. When you do an original design, it's a whole different set of critiques. And people are usually, I don't know, they're usually a little more friendly about
it.
More forgiving. They're just happy to see like, oh, look at this. This came out of their mind. And even with redesigns, most of the time people are pretty forgiving about that too. And so I think I can understand even just doing this one replica, how you could get burnt out on doing it for years. Like I loved your Alice. I was like, wow, that's so inspired. Like the if you guys are watching on YouTube, you'll see the mask behind him. I love that. I wanted to wear it with my frou-frou Alice. I'd look crazy, but I love it.
Yeah, so she's got a Cheshire Cat gas mask respirator thing going on and a little Cheshire Cat shoulder armor. I partnered up with a seamstress in Kansas City before I moved here to St. Louis. And Bethany, or Chroma, as she is online, did all the soft parts. And so custom made the jackets, all of the underclothing and all the armor that I made. We're going to have it on display at Planet Comic Con in a couple of weeks. So I'm really excited to see it all together.
I'm excited to see that too.
Oh yeah. I can't wait to see a full costume of it. So a question for you about the process of when you decided, hey, I'm going to do this Alice in Wonderland thing. Was that, was that just because you were a fan of Alice in Wonderland, or did you like do some like research of like, hey, what's something out there that people might be interested in that you don't see a lot of? I mean, what was kind of your thought process of all that?
Actually, I was going to make some new costumes for my daughters.
Oh.
And that's where it was stemmed from, was my youngest one. I mean, she's got like bright blonde hair and everything. Like, and we were trying to think of like crazy Disney princesses, you know? So like my oldest daughter, she wanted to be like this really badass Belle with like this, almost like World of Warcraft armor, like with this beast head, like on her breastplate. And then
nice.
The youngest one, we were like, well, let's do like something post-apocalyptic, you know, like Alice and all that. And I had a really simple idea in my head for hers, but then like I'm sitting there just thinking about it and, you know, got back to my roots of drawing again and actually sketched her out a couple times. And, you know, it just started to bloom from that. And it's become so big now that, you know, we're talking about possibly doing a comic book run, like a little one shot to see if people are interested. Wow.
That would be awesome.
Like, possibly doing a statue bust, you know, and have it out there for fans. So
very cool. Well, I think it was a smart decision, whether you know, had that in mind or not, to base it on a property that there's already fans of, but taking a twist of that, you know, from a classic, you know, I don't know how about, you know, copyright and stuff goes with all that, but
I think it's out on Alice in Wonderland, isn't it?
It is open domain.
Yeah. See, yeah. So I just think that was a smart decision. It's like whether you meant to or not, you know, you have that instant fan base of a twist of already established character. Because I think that's one thing where people really run up against when you start doing original stuff is like people understanding what it is and, you know, being willing to like embrace it as a new thing to be a fan of because it's something they never heard of before, you know. So anyway, I just think that that's a really was a smart decision, whether you knew you made it or not.
My favorite part about a costume that
Okay, let's get your wife on and we'll see if that's true.
Oh my gosh. My favorite part about making like an original interpretation of a character is when you're very confident that people will recognize it and they just come at you with something completely different. Like my Lich King, living on the East Coast, I went to a lot of cons in like, I guess the like Virginia area and whatnot. And people would always think I was from Gwar. This band, I had never Googled what Gwar was. And they'd be like, oh, they'd walk by me, Gwar. Oh man, that's Gwar. Like, blew my mind. It was like, of course it's the Lich King. Everybody knows the Lich King. But no, like for a while, I got mostly Gwar. So I would be like, yeah, it's Gwar. Like,
that's hilarious.
That's how I was when I did Skeletron from Turbo Kid. Like, I loved Turbo Kid. I mean, I did that as soon as the movie came out. I had it at Dragon Con 4 days later. And
well,
like
you built
four
that
people.
Fast.
Well, I'd secretly been working on the mask for about 3 weeks off little thumbnails.
Yeah.
But all the rest of the costume, I had to wait for the movie to come out so I could get everything right.
Jackie looks confused. Have you seen Turbo Kid?
Well, I want to bring something up about this because so although we didn't compete against each other on Cosplay Melee, long before I met Mr. SKS Props, we entered an Instructables contest together and we tied for first place. I made a Crusader flail from Diablo, and it was like so hard for me to make this flail. It was like the hardest project I've ever made so quickly, and wrote up like a full Instructable. And then like this guy posts that character, I think, was like the weapon.
Yep.
And it just like came out of left field. Yep. And I was like, oh man. And then
like, who is this guy?
I was like, oh man, who is this guy? And then I like clicked on his profile and I'd seen that you had done that like multiple times. So I went to enter this year. Now that we're friends and whatnot, I went to enter and I was like, oh, you know, like he's probably not entering. Oh, he's got that big old orc. No way. He wrote like a big write-up of that. And then I was like, oh yeah, he did.
Yeah.
There it is. I was like, drop that. No, not entering. No, thank you.
All right. I've kind of won the Instructables Halloween contest the last 3 years.
Yeah.
I've got 5 digital cameras over here. All right.
We both got like a nice red digital camera that year, but it's fun to enter because they give a lot of prizes. And like, so I'd be fine winning like, you know, second place even, because some of those second place challenges are crazy. But didn't you win a sewing machine this year, or was that
it's like a $1,200 sewing machine. It's a box over here.
I
did you ever unbox your 3D printer that you won?
I did. I used it 2 times.
Wow, you used it.
Oh my gosh, you were so funny. I can't believe you won a 3D printer and a sewing machine and they're just like collecting dust in your shirt. Like,
you were technology. Man, let me get my clay out and hand sculpt something.
So since the orc got brought up, let's talk about that a little bit, because I think that's maybe the thing that people know you for the most at this point, you know, because it's was such a just, whoa, you know, statement piece. Just talk a little bit about that and the creation of it.
Man, it was definitely a labor of love on that thing. I mean, in my opinion, Isaac is still my favorite costume because it was the first big build I did. I mean, that thing was 300 hours, but my orc is a very close second on there. And it's just because it is larger than life. I mean, the boots themselves are 24 inches deep, 17 inches wide and 24 inches tall. I mean, they're huge. I mean, just the engineering that went into that costume, I mean, that took me forever just to figure it all out. The entire thing's made out of foam, so only weighs about 25 pounds. Built it in about 2.5 to 3 months to take to C2E2 for the World Championships. And I was lucky enough to win first in the U.S. and place third in the world competition. So
that's pretty amazing. I had have you seen it in person, Jackie?
Yeah, I hunted him down at BlizzCon. Yeah, I only got to go to BlizzCon for a couple hours because it was the day that I left to go.
So you hunted him.
And I found him.
So you hunted him down at BlizzCon, but not me. Is that what you're saying?
Wait, you weren't at BlizzCon, were you?
Yeah, I was at BlizzCon.
I was only at BlizzCon for like an hour.
I know, and that's what I'm saying. Steven was more important than me. So
I saw her for about 35 seconds. Okay.
Yeah, he had so many. He was being interviewed, and like people were around.
No,
I was like,
no excuses.
I just walk up to the orc, and I'm like, and he's like inside. It was just, you know, it was just a little high.
I'm glad that you've seen it in person as well, because it's one thing to see it in photos. It's another thing to see it in person. And that's pretty true of most people's work, you know? And I also got to be like a quasi helpful handler for you part of one of those days too. And I think, you know, that costume is impressive. I mean, it's just like your build skill, all the detailing, and of course your paint is like fantastic. But the thing I think that impressed me the most about that costume is how easily you can get in and out of it and how modular it is. That part of it just, I was not expecting that whatsoever. And it just completely blew me away because it's what, 6 pieces? I mean,
it's next to nothing. I mean, you basically put the pants on and the muscle suit, and then you walk into the boots, grab the hands and put the helmet on.
Yeah, I literally 5 minutes or less, and I was just like, that just was so impressive to me, kind of the engineering behind it. And the tricks you did, like, you know, you have these big, huge arms with gauntlets and everything, but, you know, the axe is permanently part of the grip of the hand, so you don't have to worry about articulated hands or anything. It's just like a big glove, right? You just throw your arm in that glove, and you're an armored arm with an axe in the hand. And it's just like, it's just all the little things like that. That's a truly impressive piece of work. Did you do a lot of research about that, or was that just something you just came up with in your head as far as making it
tight? Yeah. A lot of it was in my head, because when you look at special effects industry for large costumes and for muscle suits, you can't find anything. No, I mean, those are like closely guarded secrets.
Yeah, that's true.
And so once I found out kind of how to do it, and I don't think anyone's ever done it my way by wrapping the muscles with fleece and then putting latex on it. Some people have used like spandex and stuff, but I like the way the fleece wrapped around the muscles. So of course, like once I figure it out, knowing how I am, I just put it out there for free for everybody else. And yeah, I've had lots of people use my muscle tutorials to build their own costumes, which is really, really cool.
Yeah. Don't you just love that? And just so people know that you did write up the whole build on the RPF, correct?
Yeah.
Every single one of my costumes, you will find a full build thread on the RPF.
Well, and as a maker and somebody that's been following your work for a long time, and as a friend, I just want to say thank you for doing that, because it's guys like you that really help this community grow and help people learn to create the things that they want to create. And in fact, this morning I'm part of the new Thor trailer dropped, and I'm part of a group of people building, Thor related costumes. And there was a guy in there who was like, hey, I really, really want to do, like, you know, basically Planet Hulk, you know, it's like the Hulk suit and the armor. And he's like, is that even possible? And I was like, hey, guess what? I know where to send you, you know, and I posted a couple of pictures.
Anything is possible.
Yeah. But the thing is, it's like, it's basically exactly what you did, just a different style. You know, it's just Hulk instead of an orc. But if he followed everything that you did, he could make it. And yep. relatively inexpensively, because you did it all with foam, you know. So having that resource is really cool. So, shout out to you and all the makers that we know that take the time to post on the RPF, to make YouTube videos, to work on Twitch, which maybe is a good segue into that. So I hear you have some Twitch plans.
You're getting so good at this, Aaron.
I do finally have streaming and video plans. My Woo-hoo! Fans have been asking about it for years, I'll take thousands of pictures of my work, and then I'll put them one at a time. People are like, no, I don't want to go through thousands of pictures. I want a 5-minute video that just shows me how to do it.
It's video, the compilation videos take so ever to make, though. Oh,
they do. I've shot 3 videos so far, and I'm in editing and whatnot now, and I'm like, man, this takes like 5 times longer.
Oh, yeah.
Building it.
Oh, yeah.
It drives me crazy. I don't know how people do it. It's crazy. It's like a second job.
It absolutely is. It absolutely is. So,
I'm sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
No, tell us about Twitch. We want to hear. What do you do?
So every year I stay with Bill Duran for Emerald City. Woo-hoo! And this year, Evil Ted stayed with us too.
Woo-hoo!
And of course, both those guys are big into Twitch and showing people how to do stuff. And of course, Evil Ted's like, get on Twitch. Bill's like, get on Twitch. And then, of course, the Twitch reps, you know, they've tried to get me to do it for years, too. So I'm like, you know what? Maybe, it's time. I'm getting burned out doing order after order. So I'm really slowing down orders. I want to make it fun again. And I think having some friend and fan interaction will kind of bring me back into it.
Excellent.
And so I really hope to get into 3 different types of things for my Twitch channel. So I would like for one day to be like prop building, costume building. I like another day to be digital art. I want to get back into drawing again. So I want to do some of that. You know, maybe like with this whole concept thing, let fans get in here and be like, hey, throw me ideas. Maybe I don't have the idea for it. And then third thing, I want to get back into miniature painting again. I want to do something just relaxing. And that is relaxing for me. I used to paint miniatures all the time. I never played the war games or anything because I get too attached to them. But all throughout college, that's how I made money, was I painted miniatures and I sold them on eBay and I sold them to different collectors and stuff. Paid for my entire
wedding. Give them away with war games? What do you mean you get attached? Do they kill them? Do they crush them or something?
No. It's like, if I painted them up and they're really, really cool, I wouldn't want to get rid of them. I feel bad about selling it,
So you had just tons of them. Do you still have a lot?
No, I was actually going through my boxes the other day, and I've only probably about 20 that are professionally painted miniatures. You know, I sold off just about everything, but like I said, that's how I paid for our wedding, was a guy commissioned me to paint a whole bunch of Lord of the Rings miniatures for him. And we paid off the wedding that way.
I had no idea there was that type of demand for that kind of stuff. That's crazy. So what you're saying is triple threat on Twitch coming soon.
That's right.
All right. So do you have a date when you finally decide to kick it all off? Is there
planning on starting in May?
In May. Okay. So, yep. Everybody,
after Planet Comic-Con.
And do you already have your Twitch account set up?
I do. Okay. twitch.tv/SKSprops.
So for all those who are listening and are, Twitch subscribers, it's free to subscribe to Twitch. Go over there at SKSprops. Give Steven a follow on there. Hit the little auto update thing, and then our notification. Then when he finally goes live, you'll know that he's gone live, because you'll get an email that says so. So that's cool, man. I'm looking forward to having another place to hang out on the interwebs with friends that are building cool stuff. So yeah, sweet. Let's see, where are we at with time? Okay. So are you ready to talk about Cosplay Melee a little bit, or do you have anything else that you'd want to talk about?
Post-traumatic stress, or is it okay to talk about?
I guess we can talk about this thing that happened. Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, dang, dude. Okay. Hold on. Maybe I should say this. Spoilers.
Spoilers. Gosh, Eric, you spoil everything.
I totally deserve that. Because when we talked about Cosplay Melee with Jackie, I was giving her crap about spoiling who won, you know, for the Westies, and there you go. I almost spoiled this one. So, if you haven't watched, is it episode 4, right? We're at episode 4.
Are we?
Is that
yeah,
4?
I believe
okay.
So. Yeah.
If you haven't watched episode 4 with Steven and also a friend of ours, Becca, and there's Caitlin and Josh, then I guess, you know, turn off the podcast right now. I don't really want you to leave, but, you know, if you don't want it spoiled, it's kind of hard not to have it spoiled, though.
Oh, no, just get spoiled. It's fine, guys.
Yeah.
It's not even that exciting, right, Steve?
I'm okay with it being spoiled because I just decided it's always going to be spoiled. And it was again for me this episode. So whatever. Okay.
But it wasn't me that did it.
All right. No, it wasn't. Okay.
Yeah,
so,
I know. I'm so excited about that.
So there we go.
Yeah, I love my fans in Kansas City because, you know, of course, I got just a ridiculous amount of messages last night.
Yeah.
And one guy got on there and was like, spoils, guys. And like all these other fans were like you didn't know Steve was going to do it. Like you didn't know Steve was going to, and I was like, I didn't say it, but I'm going to like that.
I love that your whole family's viewing party all had SKS prop shirts. I was like, man, that's such commitment. Like,
oh, yeah.
They just,
by the way,
they seem so supportive of you.
Repping the shirt today.
Jackie,
I don't know if you've seen last week's episode, but Jackie was repping you last week's episode.
I saw that.
I shouldn't
Jackie
say week, last episode. Episode 2, whatever. Jackie was repping SKS props. So there we go. Now I can say it. Dang, dude, you won. That's amazing.
And you went to Disney, didn't you? With the money, like you talked about.
Did you already go?
Yeah, I already went.
Yeah. Sweet.
I was going to, honestly, I'm going to be honest about this. I was going to take the girls regardless if I won or lost.
Yeah.
I told my wife that before I even went. And we already had everything planned that regardless of what happens, we're going to go take the girls because they deserve it. You know, like I said, they put up with me going all over the country, spending hours in the shop. You know, I work at home and I don't see them very often.
Yeah. I know. Being a family man, I know the exact same scenario.
Since we're both on it together, I know Eric probably has a lot of questions for you, but we talked a lot like while you were filming, because obviously it's staggered. And I know a lot about your behind the scenes experience and whatnot, but I think that now that you've seen it edited, is there anything that you wish had made it like that just was left on the editing floor? Like for me, I have little things I talked about that I wish made it so they could see more about, you know, not necessarily behind the scenes, because it's not spoiler. It just didn't make it into editing. So right. Is there anything that you wish was there?
Yeah, definitely. Day two, when I make my mask and when I make the chest armor, a lot of that got cut. Mm. And I mean, I know probably it's because of time, but also I was extremely sick. And so I don't know if that played like, he looks awful. We can't put him on TV looking like that. So people are like, man, like you built that stuff fast, but they didn't really show you. I'm like, yeah, there's probably a reason they didn't show me.
Yeah.
You know, that was one of it. But the biggest one, though, is the light challenge, because they really didn't go into this part. Mm-hmm. So Josh gets to go first, and Josh gets the ridiculous Arduino boards with like 650 light configurations, all this
activated
stuff.
Yeah, that kit looked pretty full tilt, right?
Yeah. And then Becca and I walk over there, and of course we do the thing, you pick. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, she gets hurt. She's like, oh yeah, I think this roll of LEDs will, you know, like strip LED will work for mine. And I'm like, damn. Okay. Yeah. Just go ahead and take that one. I'll deal with whatever's left. Cause I'm thinking, you know, in my mind, I'm like, well, I'm just going to put a couple of these lights in here. It doesn't matter. And then we grab our box and go on stage, and that's when they tell us, oh, this is a light challenge, and we're going to judge half your costume in the dark and half your costume in the light. And I'm like,
oh, man.
And you're like, got to step up.
I look at my box, and they didn't show this, and I couldn't believe it, because this was like one of my biggest complaints was I had one roll of nano purple LEDs, which are what I used up in the chest to illuminate. All of my other lights are Christmas lights.
the ones that are wrapped around?
Strands of, you know, like this long with those huge battery boxes on the end of them. And that's what's full in my box. And I'm like, what am I going to do with these things? And so the judge, Christian, comes in. And this guy worked on Tron. So, I mean, he knows lights, right? Mm-hmm. And he's looking in the box. And he's like, all right, man, let's see what you got. And this look just comes across his face. And I'm like, yeah, that's what I got. He's like, this is a light challenge. And I'm like, I know. He's like, well, you're going to have to do something, you know, pretty impressive with what you have here. So I tried to use every single Christmas light and light that was in that box. I didn't have the arsenal the other two did.
Man, well, you did a great job, though. I was really surprised. Like, when we had talked on like the day of your thing, I obviously didn't know about your costume, but I knew that you said you're like, I'm just going to stuff it full. I had stuffed it full completely. So it was really cool to get to see like what the final, is there a thing going on here? Why is this every episode? I'm going to have a thing going on. My eyelashes are Venus fly traps, but I love them. So I was really surprised that you were able to like stuff all that in. Like, it was pretty slimline armor. Like, it's fitted to you, and your leg piece was fitted and your arm piece was fitted. Everything was fitted. So I guess you hid your batteries and things well.
Oh, man. They're strapped. I had to make, like, little pouches inside the armor to hold all these things, because I'd be walking, and it'd just flip out, and the battery pack would just be dangling, and I'm like, oh, my God, this is just awful.
Oh, man. That's crazy.
You definitely pulled it off, though, because I mean, everything was great, but the lighting, it was just one step above the other two as far as, you know, when the lights were out, really making that shine through. And, you know, man, that mask just looks so good lit up.
Yeah.
Super and creepy, the gauntlet too.
Yeah. Was there anything you ran out of time with that with your original design you wish you could have added? Or was that exactly what you wanted to do?
It's pretty darn close to what I had. The only couple other things, I mean, of course, they have the whole costume, and they keep knocking me on, like, oh, man, I wish you had armor on your left leg.
I know.
I'm like, really? This is what? All right, if this is the biggest complaint right now, I'm doing pretty good.
Okay.
You know, I have to find something.
I have to rant for just a minute. One thing that kind of bugged me a little bit about Christian's critiques were I felt like he knocked people for things that were actually appropriate to the game that you guys were building for. You know, they knocked Caitlin in, you know, in the first half of the episode. They said that, you know, the apparatus she made, the flamethrower, didn't really fit into Overwatch, when it clearly looked like something either Junkrat or Roadhog would use. I mean, it looked, in fact, it was kind of like styled like one of Junkrat's pieces. And I was just like, are you kidding me? You know, I mean, the critique of it not being integrated enough was fine, because I agree with that. But to knock somebody for something that it clearly fit the aesthetic of the type of character she was going for, because Overwatch has different types of characters. It's not one style of game per se. It has characters that fit different molds. So that one bothered me. And then when he kind of keyed in on your leg being bare, you know, Destiny has a lot of asymmetrical armor. And so when he was like, hey, there's no armor on that part of your leg, it's like, it's straight from the game. It just annoyed me, you know, because it was like a bit of a lack of knowledge of the game. And one of my critiques against the show, I guess, from the beginning, is I would like to see, you know, it's cool to have a Hollywood guy on there, because it makes it more legit, I guess. But I would almost rather see, he would be great to, I'm not saying get rid of him, but bring on like one more person that is like a builder, prop maker, in the whole cosplay community, you know, somebody like our friend, Bill Duran from Punished Props, or Harrison Cricks, or, you know, or some of those guys that,
or Evil Ted,
or Evil Ted. Yeah. Evil Ted would be great, you know?
Yeah. They're aware of those people. And I think that the production kind of agrees with you on that. And I think Christian was definitely always going to be part, like, the Hollywood thing makes sense. And I think Leanna, like, she had good points about like cosplay items that are like when he brought up metalsmithing, and she's like, yeah, but you can't take that into a con. And like, that's, you always need to have that balance.
And you know what, like, when I first found out she was on the show and she was going to be a judge, I mean, I don't have anything against her or anything, but at first I was like, really? Because she's more of a cosplay model than, like, you know, a builder.
Yeah.
And But she's actually been one of my favorite judges because she's done a lot of conventions. She knows the scene, you know, she knows what works at a con, what doesn't work at a con. And you're right. Her insight, because she has that knowledge of con life, I guess is the word for it. Yeah. She's a great judge, therefore, you know, and I just wish there was a little more representation on the builder side of it. That isn't just Hollywood, because building for Hollywood is a completely different thing than building for fandoms and building for cons. So,
well, and the thing is, like, when you look at Hollywood build, you know, at least back in the day, talking with Evil Ted and everything, it's like a lot of the things they build aren't as good as what we do.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
because
that's very true.
They're rushing.
It's like speed over quality. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's very,
they
gotta
very
true.
They got to get it done on a budget. And we're like, no, I want this to look perfect. You know, so I'm going to take the extra time to do this.
Yeah.
And I hate that. That's hard for, like, people like us. We get in that, like, art feel, and we love each piece so much that we want. I mean, I'm on something I'm working on right now. I've remade the gauntlet so many times that I want to light it on fire, but I'm not going to give up.
Four times now?
Four times.
And I just, it's over there, and it'll never, it won't be seen until it's better. It's in timeout right now, but it would probably be fine for, like, a Hollywood set. The first one would have been fine because it's just not even that important. It's on screen. Something is on screen for like 5 seconds and people aren't really critiquing it. They're more like paying attention to the dialogue, the character, the acting, but you and like the three of us and the community, we care so much about every little detail that it's hard to step into that Hollywood environment. Like my very first time doing it was that Hearthstone commercial. And that was so hard for me. I could not believe how hard it was to like, cutting corners is not my thing, man. I don't enjoy it.
Well, that's what,
Go ahead.
Nope. On Cosplay Melee, you know, that's, I got into an argument with the producers because they said I was taking too long. I was putting too many details into my costumes and, you know, you're not going to be done in time. You know, you're doing too much.
They,
and I'm like, I don't know of any other way to do it. You know, it's like, really? This is things going to be detailed and badass, or it's not going to happen. So,
yeah. Like, have you guys, or I know Eric's probably noticed, and Steve, you've probably had questions. People have asked me, other than they've asked me how I managed to craft with my eyelashes being comfortable all day, which is easy because I use really good glue. But the other question was, they're like, you didn't prime anything or seal anything. Nope.
No,
sure didn't. Because it's shellac, because it was the fastest drying thing I could think of. Yeah. That was, you know, like, that was my only option. I couldn't use anything I normally use. I wasn't about to, I mean, we had XTC. I even put it on my list. Like, yeah, right. I was not going to be using XTC on that costume. There would have been no time.
And that was one of the things producers talked to me about. They're like, if you're going to plasti dip, you got to get it out there now. And I'm like, I'm not going to plasti dip.
Like, no. Like,
Where's my black, you know, where's the black primer? And like, well, and in one of my interviews, they're like, well, everyone else has been plasti dipping. Why aren't you? And it's like, I have to wear this one time.
Yeah.
And that primer will dry in 8 minutes.
Dude, I'm the same, man. I was just spraying. I was like airbrushing right onto the foam on pieces that like weren't, oh gosh, pieces that weren't going to be super seen. I just needed to get it black. And so it was what it was. Like that was very unnatural for me though. And strapping and stuff, like wasting time on, like, because I'm a bigger girl, everything has to be reinforced and double strapped and Chicago screws and super strong. And like, I need to be able to bounce up and down in it. I overdid it with my strapping on that. Like, it did not need to be that strong. You know, like, I could have super glued a lot of, or hot glued or super glued, or, you know, just kind of like held it there if I had to, worst case scenario. So like, the strapping was definitely, there's little things that in hindsight, if I ever, you know, come back for a rematch, I'm going to bring in. I'm just going to like hold all my armor on my body and take that extra 2 hours and put it on something else.
My shin pads on both sides, neither one of them were actually strapped. The straps came back and then I had someone come behind me with safety pins because I'm like, no one's going to see it.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't matter. Yes. I have a cape, you know?
Yeah, it's definitely, the show definitely lends towards, look over form or function, where
functionality,
where you just really, because of the time constraints, all the things that we would normally do to make something like really hold up well at a convention from people running into you and stuff, and all those different kind of reinforcement techniques and things kind of go out the door, because really it's what, a one-time walk down a runway, and then they're going to maybe put it on a mannequin at a con somewhere, because they had, you know, at WonderCon, I think it was, they had a booth at WonderCon, and they had
they had
the first two winners' costumes on display there. And so when I'm watching the show and I see somebody take the time to cut something out of foam and then wrap it in Warbler, I'm like, oh, why are you doing that? You're killing your time, you know? It's like, it doesn't need to be Warbler, because you can just paint foam. Just paint the foam. It doesn't matter. You know, you don't, it, the Warbler, I mean, unless, you know, you're starting straight with Warbler and you need to get like a really good organic shape or something, just go straight to foam, throw some shellac on it, because that'll seal it enough to, for the paint to not soak in, and just go to paint, you know? It's just, sometimes there's some things where I'm like, ah, you need to do this instead, because you're not building for quality. You're really building for speed with an amount of quality enough to impress the judges. So, so would you guys both say there's definitely a different mindset there than, than you normally build? Yeah.
It would need to be a different show. Like, obviously, you know, the Voldemort Heroes of Cosplay that we don't talk about. I mean, they went to cons, and that made a lot of sense, though.
Yeah.
Because if you could only find a good balance of that and have, like, a spinoff or, like, an end of the season where we had to wear it, and, like, whoever could make it to the finish line in their costume won $100,000. I got this, y'all. I got this. Like, I could run in it. So, like, I think that that could be a fun little, like, if there were seasons with different challenges. The way Face Off has, like, off location kind of challenges, it would be interesting to see making something that could hold up moving around or you know, in for 8 hours. So,
and that's where a lot of I think a lot of the years of experience come down to it too, of knowing, hey, what I need to do, what I don't need to do. The funniest thing about my costume is that you can actually see tips and techniques that I've used in every single costume I built up to that point.
Yeah.
I wasn't reinventing anything. You know, it was just, I know this works. Let's knock it out.
I could even see design pieces that I've seen on some of your other costumes as well, you know, like similar shapes and things. I mean, I know part of that's because of the game and you're going for a certain aesthetic for the game, but I could see how definitely everything you've built up in the, up to that point, you're like, I did this for this costume. Now I'm going to do this now because I know it works and I know I can do it quickly. And as all of us know as makers, once you do something once, it's so much faster to do it the second time.
Yeah.
And that just blows me away sometimes, you know. I'll spend like 2 or 3 hours on something. You go to make the mirror version of that and it takes 20 minutes, you know.
Yep.
I mean, I just like, why can't it just go that fast the first time?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, a question I have for both of you, being on Cosplay Melee, and this is something that just kind of, it hurts me every time I watch it, because
no,
it's not bad, because of the time constraint, right? And so, and this one, so much so this episode with Becca, because I know she really ran out of time. And when you're up there and they're critiquing you, and they're critiquing you on things that you know are wrong, or you know aren't finished because you ran out of time, and you know that you would have taken the time to finish it had you have the time. I mean, how hard is that to sit there and just take that and have it be like, well, it's really not representation of my craftsmanship, because had I had the time, I would have fixed it, you know? So, I mean,
Yeah, that's the funny thing, is that like it was 3 days.
Yeah.
Like anyone that ever, like I would love to see Christian build something in 3 days.
Well, exactly.
I would love to see, you know, Leanna build something in 3 days.
And have to talk to the camera and have to do interviews and have to do all the things that being on TV does, you know?
Yeah,
I mean, I wouldn't bother about like making sure that I, you know, looked all right on camera if I was cranking out something out in 3 days, you know?
Exactly.
And that's the worst thing. It's like, I was so nervous about how I was going to look because I did not see myself in the dark until they sent me some production photos.
Oh, wow.
I had no idea what I looked like.
You had no idea.
Oh, wow.
And so I'm like, you know, they're like, yeah, you won all this kind of stuff. I'm like, I don't know what I look like. What does this look like on? I mean, I know I won, but I'm like, does this look good? You know?
Or is
and
it
so
just,
I actually I have, I did a Photoshop thing where I had a whole thing set up where I was like, I had my costume from Cosplay Melee and my orc side by side. And it said 3 days, 3 months.
Yeah.
Just in case people are like, well, that's not very good. I'm like,
I know.
3 days.
Dude, yeah. I feel you, man. And like it's so hard because you have to own, like, it doesn't make good TV if you're like, no, but, you know, like this was what I ran out, you know, and just like stumble over yourself talking to the judges. Like it needs to have a flow. So when they critique you, you got to like, you know, just take it on the chin and just move, you know, be an adult. And I definitely like things went wrong behind the scenes for me that made it crazy harder than it should have been. But it's, you know, it's, I went with it, and it's you like hearing the critique about the shoulders and stuff, dude, I know. Like I hate those shoulders so much. I hope they never, somebody interviewed me like for this, for the press
burn
for the
them,
show.
Burn them.
I was like, I hope they will never see the light of day again. Like if I ever have to wear that costume for any reason, I'm just going to bring my own shoulders from home. And be like, just slip on and be like, what's different? I don't know. Are you sure they weren't like this? But it's, I dropped the ball. You know, you're crafting for so long and you like things went wrong and that's how it turned out. And so I had to own it. And I feel like that is hard. I've watched myself 7 times. I've watched the show 7 times, you know, just because I'm crazy like that. And like, why not? Well, I like to find funny timeline mistakes in the show, like not knocking production because they don't live in our world, but other people in like the prop tart group and like the box shop, they have mentioned things that they're like, that timeline doesn't make any sense. Oh yeah. You started painting that and you just put something together that takes an hour and 30 minutes to cure. Yeah, yeah, you exactly. did. Yeah. You know, they're zinging them and it's fun though. It's like all in jest. And so I've watched it and I see a lot of things where like I'll have a comment to Emily and then I look at the stuff on my table and it's like, that was not at that same time. That's impossible because look at the table, but nobody's really, I don't know. I enjoy watching it for those reasons. And I've watched a couple of the other episodes that way too. And I notice funny little things that are clearly, you know, different, but it's hard, you know, it's definitely hard with the amount accepting what you can create in that amount of time. But
yeah, just the thought of being up there and taking your lumps on things you know are an issue, you know, yeah. would just kill me. It's just like, I know, you know.
Well, that's like, yeah. The thing is, though, it's like, you know, I've been asked about like about the competition. Like, how did you feel about the competition? Mm. I did not think of it as a competition until we were on stage. Yeah. At no point was I like, I'm against these people, you know?
Isn't that weird, though?
And it's like, oh yeah, we have to go in front of judges. I thought it was just an accomplishment to finish this damn thing, you know?
Well, we all get a trophy, please? Like,
that definitely shows throughout all the episodes of the show, though. And I think that's just a testimony to the community and people that they have on the show. And that, you know, because everybody that's been on the show is fairly seasoned cosplayer and or creator, you know, whatever you want to call yourself. And I think it just kind of shows the attitude of the community where it's like, oh yeah, we have to compete now. You know, it's like, hey, we're just making stuff in a shop together and having a good time, you know, under a whole lot of stress. And then, okay. Oh yeah. Now we're competitors, you know? And I think that that's, you know, one of, you know, the show's not perfect and I think they've done a good job with what they have. But that's probably my favorite thing about it is how, the kind of just really positive spin, that all the makers on the show are a part of, and it's just cool to see the community represented in that way.
Yeah,
but I think the community has really appreciated it. You know, they've seemed to be. I've seen very little negativity online about it.
Yeah. Other than the first elimination, that's the only thing that people really are firmly against. They really like the camaraderie, all the way from a professional like you to like somebody who's maybe sort of new to the community. So it's crazy that like, you know, you were showcased so well on this episode. Like I felt like you look like a gentleman. You look so polite. You hugged.
Yeah. How did you trick him so much? I mean, what
the power of editing?
Did you pay off the camera crew or?
I was really good friends with the camera crew. That's one thing that I determined that you have to do.
Yeah.
Is if you're ever on that, get friends with the camera crew, because if you just need 10 minutes to yourself, just be like, I'll call you back when I'm going to do something cool.
Oh, yeah. So it's like, go bug those really other people nice for a while. That,
yeah. I did like a little tutorial on how I do my strapping, which didn't make it. But I was like, I'm crunching right now. Like, if you come right back, I'll give you a little something. So that's true. Like, as long as you got to be a good, you know, a good contestant, or they'll just nag you the whole time and you won't get anything done and they'll keep interrupting you. So they want you to have your ebb and, you know, they want you to keep flowing and crafting because you have to make something. They don't want you going on stage. They won't let you fail, you know, because it doesn't make for good TV, but it's definitely best to get along with the production and the camera team, Steve.
Wow, I think that was a little pointed there.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, maybe.
But it's I had a lot of people have talked about other ideas and what would be. I'd love to ask, since we have three of us here, it could be different opinions or different ideas. But tons of people are pitching ideas, messaging me ideas, posting about ideas, and I would love to hear if you guys have any ideas for like what would make a cool crafting style show that's different than this Cosplay Melee, whether it's groups, families. Face Off meets Cosplay Melee, anything. Like, have you thought of any other cool ideas for a show?
When I was there, I actually told them that. I was like, you know, bringing Face Off and Cosplay Melee together would be amazing because, you know, obviously these guys are really good at the makeup side of it. I'm not.
Yeah.
But I can make really cool stuff that would go along with it. The other one that I wish it would have been more like is a show that I love called Forged in Fire. And it's on, it's bladesmiths. All right.
Yeah.
And so it brings four guys in, or four contestants, cause there's some ladies in there too. And they have 4 hours basically to make a knife and they have different challenges and whatnot. They whittle them down every hour. And then the final two get to go back to their home shop for a week to build the final weapon. I'm like, if I could have gone back to my home shop and given a week, like I could build you anything, you know?
Wow. That's crazy. What an interesting challenge. I've never heard of one like that.
That would be pretty cool. Yeah. I guess, you know, I mean, I understand why Cosplay Melee is set up the way it is, you know, the type of TV that it is, but a more long form type builder show would interest me more, but I don't know if that would interest the majority of audiences either. You know, it would interest people that are interested in crafting and creating and that watch things like our podcast and other videos on YouTube and stuff. But I don't know if that would be enough for a national TV audience where you do have a week where you follow a builder and see really the quality, because you know, that's probably if there has been negativity about the show Cosplay Melee, probably the biggest one I've seen is like, yeah, but none of us work that fast, generally speaking. You generally don't build a full armored costume in less than 3 days. I mean, people have and can.
Don't do it.
But it's, you know, it's just kind of like, it's not real life when it comes to, you know, the cosplay scene. Yeah. And yeah, you know, most of us spend at least a month or more, you know. Some of us have done it in 2 weeks. I haven't. I can't. There's no way. I work too slow. So for me, you know, like more of a long, because I really like to see the building side of it, right? Mm-hmm. I want to see people's techniques. I want to see how they're achieving certain looks of things. And, you know, the TV show just doesn't have time for that, you know, because it's really more about creating that tension. And I get it. It makes for compelling TV. But for me, that's what I'd rather see. But I'm glad that it exists the way it does, because before that, you know, there was only the other show, and you know, we all know how people felt about that. So,
some ideas that I've thought about are like last summer, those of you that listened to Tested, Adam Savage mentioned that he had pitched a cosplay show to a network. Well, I don't know whatever happened with that. I know he's doing like Brain Candy now, but I just feel like something out of Adam Savage's brain regarding makers and cosplay would be good.
Yeah.
So like whatever
there definitely
idea you're sitting on, I'd love to see that come to fruition. And I also like Walter Welsh, if you're out there, I would collab with you on Face Off if we get to pick our buddies. But I think it would be fun to do the Face Off Cosplay Melee. I think that's a natural.
Oh, I get SIG then. I get SIG.
Oh no, I like SIG too. No. Thighs out. I'm wearing boxes right now, SIG. Dude, SIG is my guy. I love Thighs Out. Like I tweeted at him about that. They're so funny. And he has the best headpieces. We would just match. It's so good. But it would be fun to do like teams. Like two Cosplay Melee and two Face Off, a team of four, longer period of time, more in-depth build. And that way you'd see like two people of the same thing, like two costumers talking about techniques and things that they're doing and dividing up the work and what you could create with four people in a certain amount of time, like, I don't know, four teams of four or something. And then, I don't know. I don't know what the format would be. You know, that's not my world, but I think that that would be really cool. I would just love to see, like, looking back at the Warcraft episode, when the Warcraft movie was coming out, and, like, the makeup. They did, like, a Draenei and a few other things. And, like, man, could we have please been on that? Because those costumes, like, dude, get out of here.
It's like, yeah, your makeup's great. Let us build your armor.
Oh man, there's so many video game like world mashups where it just naturally lends itself to like cosplayers and special effects artists. Like that would just be such a fun format. And I don't know, there could be so many cool twists. But I love like Project Runway had a AARP sponsored special where they had a surprise model as opposed to their normal like, you know, average size model, and it was their family member. And they both got the winner and the family member got $50,000 to win that for whoever won that challenge. And they had to create something that looked good and that their like mother or sister liked. So it was the craziest thing to like watch this family and like the critiques and the dynamic between the maker and the family member. Cause if I had to make a costume for like my mom or my dad, oh my gosh, like it would be hard to even get them to like push the envelope on some of these crazy things. Like mom would be like, no skull, don't put any skull on that. No, I'd love to see that. And like, could you imagine your wives? Like, dude, that'd be so cool. Or even your kids. It'd be fun. I think if they had a season or an episode with everybody's kids, like, dude, or like little nieces or nephews, because they're small, a lot easier to make for, too.
I'd actually, I talked to my family about that regarding my Twitch channel, is that I'd like to try to do some family builds where we go out in the shop as a family and try to do something.
That's so cool.
Well, they all say they're up for it. And I'm like, oh, yeah, we're doing it cosplay melee style. We're not leaving this shop for 3 days.
Food poisoning and all. Yeah. You're going through what daddy went through.
Yeah,
how old are your kids? I know how old Eric's are, but are yours
11 and 8?
Oh, 11 and 8. Okay.
Yeah, he's a little younger than I am. So there you go. I was going to say that, recently my daughter, we were working on stuff for Emerald City Comic Con last month, or maybe 2 months ago now. I don't remember what month it is now even. And having her in the shop working, she was working on her costume as well and, you know, kind of leading her through that. And so she ended up on my Twitch stream a couple times. It was actually really fun to have somebody to kind of partner with while streaming, you know? So I would say, if you get the chance to do that with your family and stream it and stuff, go for it, because we had a really good time, you know? So, and my kid actually happens to be pretty funny too. So it's kind of nice to have her on there to be a little comic relief.
That's cool. I love that.
Especially my oldest daughter. She's very artistic like me, and she really wants to get into it. I mean, she was going to school. She's like, I told so many people at school, you're going to be on TV, daddy.
Oh yeah. I'm glad you brought that up. Cause that's something I never would have thought about. Were people like super like her friends and stuff? Were they like, nah, you know, were they pretty excited or?
Yeah, it's a cool thing. You know, it's like I really liked on this show. They showed a lot of family stuff with me. It seemed like every time I was on the camera, I was talking about my family.
And
it's like,
dude, that's awesome.
Do you build stuff? No, I've got a wife and two daughters. Yeah, that's. But I was really happy that they got in that segment of me when I took the orc to her school.
Yeah, that was great.
Dude, I didn't even know that. That's so cool.
I know. I was like,
my kids in her class, like I was over in the corner. I saw like her friend, little friend, come to. It's like, your dad's awesome. And I'm like, I heard that.
No, that's super cool, man.
Really cool. That was probably the coolest thing of all the things of all like the background that they've given all the contestants this season. Like, I don't know, you were like my favorite. I was like, dude, please, oh my gosh, that'd be so cool. I wish I had a cool dad like that.
Yeah,
dude, you won the hearts of every kid in America with that.
And I can attest that that wasn't just like a TV thing either, because we've known each other for a while. We've had many conversations, and you know, your family always comes up in conversation. So, you know, the fact that you you know, do what you do and then are a very conscious family man on top of it, you know, my hat's off to you, because I'm the same guy, and it's not easy to do what you do and have a family at the same time. And what it really comes down to is having an extremely supportive wife.
Yes.
Extremely supportive wife. So I don't know if my wife has ever even listened to the podcast, but you know, just a shout out to her, because I wouldn't be able to, you know, because prop making and stuff isn't a full-time job for me. So everything that I do that surrounds that cuts into family time or time that I could be spending with her. Instead I'm, you know, spending time with, you know, random people on the internet. No, I'm just joking. You guys are more than random. I'm just teasing. So, but yeah, really. And I know you probably, I mean, I'm sure you feel the exact same way, because when you're not doing things, that means somebody else has to do it. And that's usually your wife, you know? So.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Like I said, they've been very supportive through all of this. I mean, in the very beginning, when I told her that I was going part-time to build props full-time, like, that was a difficult conversation.
I bet. But, I bet.
But since then, everything's been going good.
Well, that's good to hear, because, you know, it's being an independent artist, basically, because that's what you are, right? You're an independent artist. I mean, you can make a living that way, but it's a very difficult way to make a living. And I know a lot of people in the community that, you know, have that ideal and want to get there. You know, I would even consider myself included in that group, you know. But getting there is definitely a difficult road, especially if you have a family, because that's, you know, depending on the size of your family, with you and I, that's three more people that we have to consider when we're paying bills and buying food and, you know, paying for a place to live and stuff. So, when you have that on top of it, makes going independent a much more difficult prospect. So,
yeah, not to mention too, you know, it's that whole, I get that, I'm sure you do too, but I get that email a lot of how do I become a full-time prop maker? And I'm like,
all the time.
Lord, don't do it. Yeah, like, yeah. If you really enjoy building, it's like, don't make it your job, because it will eat at you slowly but surely.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why, like I said, even with me, I'm a little burned out, and that's why I'm going to try some new things, you know, try to kind of rekindle my love for building stuff. And, you know, it's like, I would like to just get back into playing games. You know, the whole reason I started doing all this.
Yes, yeah. Please. Yeah. I miss video games so much. Like, I've played very little lately. I played Conan Exiles for like 2 days, like solid, because I just binge it like the same way I would binge anything else, like crafting. I just I had a lot of fun playing Conan Exiles. That's a good game. And like, I played Ark a little bit, but I don't have time to play WoW like I want to. And I have Overwatch. I played Overwatch one time in the last like 2 months. Like, I don't know. There's no time for things like that. You have to absolutely make a choice. If you want this to be a job, you have to be prepared to give up a lot. Like, it is not the same as a 9-to-5 job and you get home and you're like, you can veg out, go to sleep, get up, repeat. That may be boring and mundane and you may wish for something else, but you have to think of all the things you're giving up. You're giving up a lot of freedom, a lot of free time, because every moment for us is money. Every moment
I could be working right now. Think
me
about
too.
That.
Yeah, it's like,
yeah, very true.
There's never something that can't be sanded, never something that can't be content, never something that can't be written up. Like, we could literally work around the clock and just be, you know, like a hamster wheel all the time, trying to catch up with people that already have established careers or trying to get, you know, work. It's very hard. It's something that you have to throw yourself into. And the earlier, the better in life, I would say, when you have more energy and you can burn the midnight oil and it doesn't affect you as much. Like, the older and older I get, my gosh, like, this morning I woke up and I was like, I feel like death. I worked in here all day yesterday. I was like, this is crazy. Like, I could play video games for 22 hours solid when I was like 20. And now I'm standing here crafting, and I finally closed up shop at 1 a.m. And I got up this morning and my dogs woke me up, and I was like, oh, this is like, you feel like work hungover. You know what I mean? You just, like, your legs need a break, and it's hard, but you have to just keep doing it and hope you'll build up some kind of endurance.
Wait till you
hear. No joke. My wife kept track, and in like 3.5 years, it was less than 2 weeks worth of days that I was not in my shop, not counting conventions, but I'm in my shop where I'm working every single day.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And for me, you know, I have the full-time job, and then, you know, pretty much every day of on my days off, I'm in my shop or creating content or doing something, prop making related. So yeah, it's definitely, physically demanding and mentally demanding to keep that creative going all the time. And in all honesty, when I get at the end of, like, I finished Emerald City stuff, you know, when Emerald City was at the beginning of March this year. And I really haven't made anything since, because I've just been like, ugh, you know, I had that mad rush at the end.
Oh, that,
I still have a couple costumes I need to finish that I didn't finish for the con, because the first time I've ever had that happen. And I just most of the time just don't want to do anything. So
it's like I built the orc and finished C2E2.
Yeah.
And I hadn't built anything new until I started Death Dealer a couple months ago.
Oh, yeah. I was just like excited about that because I just was reminded of Death Dealer. So, exactly. I mean, you took a big long time. But at the same time, though, you're still cranking stuff out, though.
It's I still got a ridiculous amount of orders and whatnot that I just hadn't made anything for myself.
Yeah. Oh, gotcha. Have you ever kept track of like how many Borderlands masks you've made?
Not specifically on Borderlands, but I will say that I've sent out over 1,000 orders in the last 3 years.
Holy cow, dude. That is a lot of work.
It is.
Wow.
Considering I hand paint every single one of them.
Yeah, no kidding.
That's crazy.
So, but Death Dealer, that's just a project for you, right?
Yeah, personal project. It's one I'd want to do it was the second costume I ever wanted to build.
That's very cool.
The second con I went to was in Chicago Wizard World, and they had 22 of his original paintings on display, which I'm a huge Frazetta fan.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like when I was there, the original Death Dealer was on display, and I was like, holy crap. Like, I didn't ever think I'd be able to see it.
Like the actual original?
The
actual painting?
Was there.
Wow, and that's awesome. I would love to see
it. This close to it. Oh, but then there were like 5 armed security guards around. So I didn't get any closer than that.
What? It's crazy.
But, yeah. I mean, that's like, that's iconic. I mean, Frank Frazetta's work is like,
let me go grab the helmet. Right
back. Okay. Yeah. Grab it. I mean, I don't know if everybody here is familiar with his work. I hope you are. If you're not, I'm going to have
to Google it.
Okay.
No. And him and I have talked about it so much because I know he's like giving their daughters a piece.
Yeah.
But I forgot to like look up what it was. I've just been watching.
Well, you would know. You'll know. I mean, it's like it's such an iconic piece of artwork. And so I've been watching a really cool show by Comic Book Girl 19, and it's called Greater Creators. And she has a whole episode on Frank Frazetta. And I was familiar with his work before I watched that, but I didn't realize how much of an influence he was with the whole kind of fantasy genre. And he basically, basically single-handedly started that genre. And
wow, really?
Yeah, basically, as far as the aesthetic and the style of it. And you probably have seen, and whether you know his work or not, you've at least seen his Conan work because that's everywhere. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, just clicking on that, I realize what that is.
Yeah,
I didn't know his name now.
Yeah. And then he did some Princess of Mars stuff too. So he basically is the godfather of fantasy genre art, really, when it comes down to it. So, okay, let's look at that. Oh, that helmet is awesome. Yeah, dude.
Is that paint or is it cold cast? I forgot to ask you.
This one is spray paint, but then airbrushed and rub and buff.
Wow.
Oh, okay. What rub and buff is it? Like which metal colors, like titanium or stainless steel?
It's stainless.
The stainless, okay.
Yeah.
That's nice.
But yeah, that helmet, you know, the hardest thing about it is that Frank only had one drawing that he ever showed what the helmet looked like. In all of his paintings, it's always blacked out. You always just see the red eyes. But he did one drawing for Frank Bowen when they did the statue back in the 90s. And so I based it off of that and then had my own kind of artistic interpretation. The really cool thing is that since he's passed, the company's been broken up between all the siblings, and his daughter and granddaughter run the Frazetta Girls, and they're trying to keep the legacy alive and everything. They have been blown away by the helmet.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
And
that's really cool.
You know, when Holly, his daughter, goes, my dad would have been proud of what you've done.
Dude, that's amazing. That's amazing.
And I'm really excited because they're going to be at Planet. My goal is to have the costume complete at least so they can see the entire thing.
That would be amazing.
That's going to be so cool. They're going to love it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a cool project, man. I'm glad that you're taking it on. I mean, have you ever, when you when you were looking at it, have you ever seen many people do that costume?
No.
I've never seen anybody.
There is only one of the company that made the helmet.
Yeah.
It's not very accurate. And they were like $5,000 because they were actual metal and everything. Holy crap. I'm like, and so I'm like, why has no one ever made this? Like,
yeah, that's surprising to me. Yeah.
That's very surprising to me. Once again, like I seem to always have this knack of choosing something right before it gets cool.
Yeah.
And so it's like,
all right, I'm going to pay more attention to what you're doing from now on. So. No, man, that's cool, man. I mean, part of it's having that intuition, right? So, I'm really looking forward to seeing that complete. When's that con coming up again? Is that pretty soon or?
Well, technically, I wanted to have this done for C2E2 next week, so I'm going to be busting my butt. I mean, honestly, if I can build a costume in 3 days, why can't I finish this?
Yeah, right? Come on, man.
You won. What's wrong with you?
Yeah, yeah.
I hope to actually have it done and ready for C2E2 next week.
Oh, very cool. Is that next weekend then?
Like
2 weekends from now?
But you're not competing,
this weekend. Next. No, I'm not competing this year. Since I won last year, I don't think I can.
I didn't know they had that rule.
Yeah, at least they did 2 years ago. But I was like, you know what?
They're read pop, right?
Yeah, I mean,
I'm pretty sure that you can't. I'm pretty sure you can't the next year.
But the thing is like with the orc, I placed first in the U.S. and third in the world with that. It's like,
where are you going?
Yeah, it's like it's just like down from there.
Yeah, I mean, other than cosplay melee, or people be like, oh yeah, whatever. It's like terrible. He cheated.
This is going to be my, I quit cosplay.
Yeah.
All right. I'm done. I've done everything.
All right. You've heard it here first on Crafting Geek. No.
Dude, and that's like, it's so funny because you won and I didn't win. And so like I won some contests, you know, before I got into, while I abused the mic, sorry. I won some contests before I put myself out there to compete in front of the world and I lost. And so like, you're lucky you won because you can feel, you know, like you hang your head high and you feel good about it. And like, I'm not a sore loser. Like, I'm not like, oh man, you know, like I should have won. But it doesn't feel great to have not won. I would like to redeem myself, but that is definitely something you have to consider. Like if you're somebody who, I don't come from that state of mind where I'm like, oh, I always must win everything. I can't lose. I want to keep getting better to hope that I win. But if I don't, I will look at that as like, you know, there must be, I will look at my competition and try to learn from where I went wrong and what I can improve. Like as an artist, I don't take it really as personally, which I know some artists really take it personally. It gets them in the gut. I luckily, whatever part of the brain turns that off, I have it turned off. And I didn't take the loss that badly. But I like a lot of people that ask about auditioning on the show, I'm like, man, if you don't like to lose, like don't do it because there's you never know. You could be the best artist I know, but when you get there, it could all fall apart. You could get sick or the cameras could freeze you up or you could do any, I mean, like so many things could go wrong. You could have anxiety and not sleep every night so that you're exhausted when you're on set.
I had that too. All right.
Yeah, dude, I slept 1 hour one night. It was great. I was like, I can't sleep at all. So it's, if you're going to compete in front of a lot of people, you got to have like a certain bit of, you got to have like rhino kind of skin and be able to take a lot of critiques and accept your fate. And so when I made the decision, like if I lose, oh, well, that was when I realized like, all right, I think I could actually go through with this because I don't know if you had second thoughts.
I had
all
a lot
the way
of
up
second thoughts.
You went. Yeah.
I was like, you know, I actually asked like, why in the hell am I doing this? Like, yeah. I'm already known for like creating cool things. Like I don't need to prove anything to anyone. And like, why in the hell am I even going on this show? Yeah. You know, it's like the only thing I have is like, if I do well, all my fans expect it. Right.
Yeah.
Which I saw from all the comments before anything ever came out. It's like, you better win. And I'm like, yeah, that's my fans right there.
Hey,
I'm
cold. Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, if I do well, everyone expects it. If I do bad, it could be detrimental to my business and what I do and whatnot. But
yeah, that yeah, I was worried about that. That was my, I mean, I'm right with you on that. Once I lost like that day, I was like, nobody's going to hire me for anything. This is terrible. Like you have that like overwhelming feeling of like, I didn't lose. Like, I'm not upset that I personally lost. I'm upset that like, this might affect my career just like you. So luckily I got a job after that, but that's where it all comes down to being able to be somebody that people want to work with, having a positive personality, a positive outlook, and being a problem solver, critical thinking. I'm not saying I am all these things. I'm saying that even if you lose competitions, if you still are a great maker and have all these great workability traits, you'll be fine. Like you can lose competitions. It won't matter, but it's, you have to just, you know, you gotta be able to separate that. Cause you know, there can only be one winner of Cosplay Melee. Right, Steve? And he is here.
But one winner per episode. Yeah, I haven't faced all the rest of them yet.
Well, I know, dude, I'm down for that. Can you please take them all on?
I don't want to do that. I don't want to go back.
You know, I want to. So
please don't maybe come back. But you're under contract. You may have to go back.
Give me 5 days instead of three, Vin.
There you go. Yeah. Well, as a person that didn't participate on the show, I will say that from an outside perspective, I don't think people really see you guys, you know, as like one is a winner, one is a loser. I mean, it's just kind of like, it's almost like, especially if you're somebody that is a builder or a creator and knowing the time constraints and knowing the limits and everything and what you're up against, I think I see it more as like, wow, they survived and they survived really well. They just didn't happen to have the costume the judges liked the most. Because really, in all the episodes I've seen, at least two of the costumes, if not all three, if they would have picked the other person, I would have been just as like, okay, I get it. Yeah, I totally understand, you know, because I think that just kind of a testimony to the quality of the people they have on the show. It's like, there really hasn't been anybody on there that's like, if they had won, I'd been like, oh, that's a disaster. I can't believe they picked that person, you know? Yeah. So I think you guys are a little hard on yourselves is what I'm getting at. So
always, we're artists.
Yeah, I know. We're all hard on ourselves, but really, and like you said, I think the most important thing is how you're portrayed and how you handle yourself, and you have people on there, you know, and you go on and you look good, your positive attitude, you're helping people out, you know, you're somebody that's teachable or trainable or whatever. And if you're, you know, I think people are more concerned about those kind of qualities than, hey, can they make X, Y, or Z? Because we all know people, right? I mean, we know hundreds of people in our community that are amazing builders.
Yeah.
We do. And mm-hmm. You know, but some rise to the top and some don't. And a lot of it has to do with attitude.
Yeah,
so,
yeah,
definitely. I don't know if you've got this, Jackie, but I mean, they're asking when they're talking about season two, like, do you have any friends that you'd recommend?
Yeah.
And I got down and I started looking at who could do this, who would have a personality to do it. And I'm like, out of all the friends I have, I'm like, I drop it down to like three or four people. You know, I'm like, they could really do this.
I think I recommended like seven people, like, because a lot of people, I mean, my best friend Liz doesn't want to do it, you know, and I think her personality is muy bueno. Like, I love that girl, but she doesn't really want to go on TV, and that's just not her thing. So like, I have a lot of friends that the TV aspect, you know, just shakes them to the core and they don't want to do that. Or they are somebody, just like Eric said, they take their time, they're slower. And then other people that taking off work isn't an option, or they're in school. So there are people that there were more that I thought maybe had the personality edge, but just life gets in the way. But there are just as many that I know that it would be hard for the producers to make them look nice. I've got a couple, I love my grumpy friends, but they're a little grumpy. So I don't want them to look like villains on TV. So, you know, if they want to do it, I'll put a good word in, but I just want to warn them that, you know, they could always show your real side.
Okay, what I want to know is now, is hashtag Jackie's grumpy friends going to be a thing now? Are they all gonna out themselves? And
Do you think people right now are just like, am I one of those people?
Are you?
Only when you're in your grumpy cat makeup. Oh yeah, Steven. So yeah.
Which grumpy cat is coming to Dragon Con? Woo-hoo! Okay, that will be one of my Dragon Con costumes.
Are you,
Jackie? Are you coming to Dragon Con?
Me or him?
You first off, and then Eric.
I don't know. It all depends on, I know they're like talking about having a Cosplay Melee panel, and they're still picking, I guess, from all the people that, I don't know, submitted to be part of that. So like, if they pick me, I mean, I know all of us submitted, but like you didn't.
I didn't submit.
I know you're the only one. You're like, dude,
I don't do panels at Dragon Con. All right. That's my role.
I love that Steve is the diva. I mean,
you don't want to work at Dragon Con, right? You don't want to work.
I had to get up and do a chandy leather panel at 8 o'clock AM on a Sunday morning. That was awful. All right.
I would die. I mean, I feel you. I did the news, the morning news, like not the morning news, like nine. I did
like the 5 a.m.
The 5. And so I had to be there at 4. And that was probably the worst. And I was in Lich King. It was the worst thing I've ever done. And like never again. Yeah. I mean, I would do it again because it was she was really cute and fun. But it was the morning stuff. If you have to be in costume, were you in costume for that?
No, that was just a demo and whatnot. I'm like, no one's going to show up. And it was like a packed room. I'm like, what are you people doing? Did you all not stay out and party as late as I did?
See, I thought it would be really fun. Like I submitted in my application thing. I thought it'd be fun to do some like workshops because last year I've always tried like 2 years in a row. I tried to sign up for the workshops for DragonCon and they sell out so fast and you can't ever get in them. And I was like, man, they should do more of these, but maybe there's not enough people willing to do them. And I would totally do a workshop. Like I love that. Like, a room full of people, full of supplies. Let me show you how to make this. And then we can all dress up together and leave as a horde, like all wearing stuff. So I would love to do that.
Hashtag Jackie's horde. There you go. Yeah, that's another horde. One.
Yaya had a horde last year of all people wearing the wigs dressed like her. I'll have like a breastplate horde. We'll just dress together.
Okay.
I love that. I love making stuff. So that would be fun. But Dragon Con is the most packed con I've ever been to. It even beat San Diego for me just based on like density. Oh, yeah. So it was, I can understand like why you wouldn't work it because you have to leave. It's like LA traffic. You need to leave like an hour before you have to be there just to walk through the line of people and get an elevator.
You get stuck in the hamster tubes. Yeah.
Oh, I hate that. They're so hot. Like that, if you're going to get claustrophobic, that's where it's happening, dude. Like it was pretty crazy. I couldn't believe how many people are packed in that. But I want to go to Dragon Con just because I didn't have the best experience last year. I think because I really just, I didn't really know what to expect. I had a great time at the aquarium, but I was talking to Bill and Britt and everybody else, and they're like, you know, you're hanging out, you need to hang out with the right crowds and do these things
mm-hmm.
And so I think if I went this year and got to hang out with some of my maker friends and went to like the RPF meetup and stuff, that would be fun. I'd like that. Eric should go too.
I would like to go. I just don't know if it's going to happen this year, so we'll see.
Workshop.
What's that?
Offer to do a workshop.
No, I'm not working.
You don't work at Dragon Con.
I'm willing to work for my supper, Dragon Con. If you're out there, just, you know.
No,
it's you guys just, are like, nah, dude, too much work.
It's hard because it's hard for me to get time off if I don't have it scheduled like a year in advance. So
that's rough.
So that's really the biggest thing. And then, you know, it's expensive to travel. So I
it's
have
a
to,
long flight too.
And it is. So I have to look at, you know, the con schedules and stuff and see where I can, you know, go inexpensively. And, you know, Dragon Con is usually just the most expensive one. So
that's usually what
it comes down
to. It was
to,
expensive so, last year.
Yeah.
I was surprised.
So, okay. Well, I think that, you know, we're hitting about an hour and a half here. So, I think that's probably about a good time to kind of call it a show. Steven, do you have anything else that we touched on that you or didn't touch on that you'd like to say or anything, give you an opportunity for any last thing or you
no,
feel
I, mean, I guess the only thing that we touched on, like I said, just come follow me on Twitch, you know, see what I'm going to be putting out there. You all have asked for it.
Yes.
So you have to come.
Yes.
You have to come and take a look. How many people, you know, it's like, oh, like SKS Props t-shirts, right?
Yeah.
How many people wanted them? Come buy them.
Yeah.
You're going to have them for sale at Planet, aren't you?
I'm going to have a whole bunch of shirts at Planet. But then anyone that wants to see any of my props or shirts or anything, you can always hit up my Etsy store. So it's etsy.com/shop/SKS props. But no, like I said, the Twitch thing I'm really excited about. I've been going on there and checking people out and, you know, stopping and I look at Eric's videos, but then I look at Eric and Eric's following everybody else's videos. So every room I go in, Eric's already in there. So
dude, that is always the truth. For last year, I ran into him everywhere, every single channel. It was crazy. Even somebody with like 10 followers, Eric's one of them. He's in there. I don't know how he has this much time. Like
ridiculous. I just, you know, whenever I'm working on something, I just always have Twitch on in the background.
Yeah.
So, because I really like the Twitch community a lot and getting to know a lot of other makers and stuff. And it's really a nice collaborative community as far as like helping each other out and following each other's feeds and participating in chat and, you know, I'm like a moderator for the chat on like 3 or 4 different channels now. And, you know, other people that I've met over there are moderators on my channel and are, you know, and it's just like, it's just a really cool little community. So, but you do that by just looking around and looking for people. Yeah. And
you won't miss them if you like, even when I silenced my phone a bit ago, it was saying Vulpin Props has gone live. Like I have all my makers. I don't have everybody set to live, like all the gaming channels, but all my makers, I set for notification.
You know where they're going on.
Yeah. So if you're just sitting in your shop crafting, you forgot, like, oh, I could watch somebody on Twitch while I'm doing this. You're looking for content, like just set notifications. And then, you know, like Harrison and Bill and Ted, like they're all, a lot of them are really staggered times and they'll come on right after each other. It's like TV programming.
Yeah. It really is. It really is. And mine's really sporadic because of my work schedule. So I can't set a day because I can't do it the same day every day because my work schedule rotates. So
set a day and let us all know, right, Steve?
I will. Yes. Yeah, but I'm thinking about like Mondays doing some drawing and then Wednesdays doing some digital art and throwing some miniature painting in there every now and then.
Very cool.
I like it. All right.
Very cool. So there you go. Thank you, Stephen, SKS Props, for being on the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys.
Our third episode and our first guest. So, and
for
just some little housekeeping for the podcast itself is we do plan on having guests on quite often, maybe not every episode, but more often than not. So look forward to meeting other makers, prop makers, cosplayers, creative type people on the show. And we now have a Facebook page as well. So if you go to Crafting Geek, if you just type that into Facebook, you'll find our Facebook page. That'll be updated frequently. If you know, like we knew Steven was coming on, so I was able to put on there, hey, Steven's going to be on. Do you have any questions specifically for him? So follow our page on Facebook and, you know, submit questions and things like that if we post about the person that's going to be on. And then always we can be found at www.craftinggeek.com. So other than that, I guess we're done.
Awesome.
Everybody say goodbye. We're done.
Bye, guys.
Goodbye.